Good morning, children. I'm your physics tutor, Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Ramakrishnan. Today, I am going to cover the chapter Electromagnetic Induction and Alternating Current. Both are interrelated with each other, so I'm going to cover both the topics together. Before that, let us quickly discuss how to access this Clay6 page. Go to clay6.com. You can see this is our home page. Click onto the practice session. You can select the package, premium. There you have the revision notes. Click on that. You can see the revision notes, which has the important formulae and the concepts for all the three subjects, physics, chemistry, and biology, which is very much required for NEET exams. When you crack the exams, time management is very, very important. Once you are thorough with the concept and the formulae, analyze the question properly, look into the data given, quickly recollect what formula is to be applied. If you are thorough with the concepts and the formula, then it is going to be pretty easy for you to crack that question. So that is why we have made this revision notes for all the three subjects, that is physics, chemistry, and biology, chapter wise, right from the first chapter to the last chapter for both grade 11 and 12. See, you can see this. So it comes along with the package. You can choose your package and buy this, and then once you are done with this, you can take as many tests as you can, which we have also provided. Later on, we'll go to the test. Before that, let me quickly go through the lesson, electromagnetic induction. Here, the first thing you have to know is the magnetic flux. So Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, EMI stands for electromagnetic induction. First one is, magnetic flux phi is equal to N into B dot A. Now, you know, dot product B vector dot A vector is nothing but N B A cos theta, where N stands for number of turns, B for magnetic induction, and field strength or magnetic field. A is the area of cross section, and theta is the angle of orientation. Induced EMF, E is equal to minus d phi by dt. Self-inductance or self-induction, phi is equal to Li, where L is the self-inductance. So E is equal to L into di by dt. L is equal to mu 0 n squared A by L, where mu 0 is the permittivity, n squared is, n stands for the number of turns, A for area of cross-section area, and L is the length. Mutual inductance, phi is equal to MI, where M stands for mutual inductance, I is the current. E is equal to d phi by dt into dm into di by dt. Remember, di by dt, or which is nothing but M into, where M is equal to mu 0 N1 N2 A by L. Mutual inductance, as the name indicates, it is now going to be the mutual inductance between the two coils. So that is why we take the terms, I mean, we consider two coils where the terms of number of turns for each coil is now going to be N1 and N2. Next, coming to electric generator, maximum EMF E is equal to E0 sine omega t. E0 is equal to NAB omega, where omega is angular acceleration, B is the magnetic field, A area, and N is the number of turns. E is equal to minus d phi by dt. E is equal to NBA 2 pi mu sine 2 pi mu t. Suppose if omega is angular velocity, children. Omega is not given, and instead of that, mu is given. The frequency is given, then you can say 2 pi mu. Omega, instead of omega, you can substitute 2 pi mu. So look into the data, look into the question properly, see what is given, and then decide which formula you have to use. Next is motional EMF. When a conductor of length L moves in a magnetic field B with a velocity B in a direction perpendicular to B, The induced EMF setup across the ends of the conductor is E is equal to BLB, where B stands for magnetic field, L is the length, and B is the velocity. When the conductor rotates about one of its ends in the perpendicular magnetic field, then E is equal to half V omega L squared, where V omega is going to be the angular velocity. When a disk of radius r rotates with a uniform angular speed omega in a perpendicular magnetic field B, the EMF induced between the axis of disk and its rim is E is equal to half V omega r squared, where r is the radius. These are the miscellaneous things you'll have to know. Electric motor, efficiency of a DC motor is given by eta is equal to output mechanical power divided by input mechanical power, which is equal to EI by VI, which is equal to where E is the electric current and V is now going to be the potential difference applied, or E is the EMF, electromotive force EMF by V, or II gets cancelled, so it is simply E by V. For maximum efficiency, E is equal to V by 2. Current through armature coil, E is equal to V minus E by R, where you know the armature coil is, armature is the axis which rotates a coil. So current through the armature coil is given as E is equal to V minus E by R. Now coming to the alternating current. AC circuit on AC circuit containing R, L and C, where R stands for resistance, L for inductance and C for capacitance. Impedance of RLC circuit Z is equal to root of R squared plus XL minus XC, or IV is equal to EV by Z, where I stands for the current, E is the EMF and Z is the impedance. Tan phi is equal to XL minus XC by R. Here, XL is called as the inductive reactance and C is called as the capacitive reactance. Electric resonance, at resonance XL is equal to, when XL is equal to, at resonance, you know, XL is equal to XC. So in that case, omega L will be equal to 1 by C omega, where XL values, value of X, I mean, you can write XL as omega L, where L stands for inductance, and 1 by C omega is for XC. So when they are equal, you can equate these two. Omega L is equal to 1 by C omega, or from this, we get cross multiply this and get omega squared is equal to 1 by LC, or omega is equal to 1 by root of LC. So this is at resonance. So resonant frequency is given by, you know, omega is 2 pi nu. So omega resonant frequency is given by nu is equal to omega by 2 pi, which is equal to 1 by 2 pi root of LC. At resonant frequency, Z is equal to R. Remember children, Z is equal to R. IV is equal to EV by R, which is equal to maximum. At parallel resonant frequency, IV is equal to 0. Q factor for resonance, Q is equal to I by R root of L by C. This is very, very important. Sorry, 1 by R root of L by C. Energy stored in condenser, inductor and LC oscillations. Energy stored in a capacitor, VC is equal to Q squared by 2C, which is equal to half CV squared, because we know Q is equal to CV, which is equal to half QV. Energy stored in an inductor, UL is equal to half LI squared. Average power consumed per cycle in pure inductor is zero. Remember, average power is always zero. Average power consumed per cycle in an ideal capacitor is zero. The natural frequency of energy oscillation is given by nu is equal to 1 by 2 pi root of LC. Power associated with AC circuits, power factor. Average power dissipated per cycle in an non-inductive circuit, XL is equal to XC. P is equal to EV IV. EV times IV. Average power dissipated per cycle in RLC circuit is P is equal to EV IV cos phi. EV IV cos phi. So power factor cos phi is given by true power by apparent power, which is equal to R by Z, which is equal to R by root of, you know, Z is nothing but R squared plus XL minus XC the whole squared. So substitute. So that gives you R by root of R squared plus XL minus XC the whole squared. Transformer. Transformer is a device where you can if you want to, you can change the voltage. If you want a high voltage, you can change it using a step up transformer. If you want a low voltage, you can use it by using a step down transformer. So efficiency of a transformer is given by eta is equal to ESIS divided by EPIP, where ES is going to be the EMF of the secondary coil, and IS stands for the current in the secondary coil. EP is the EMF in the primary coil, and IP is the current in the primary coil. Transformer ratio K is equal to ES by EP, which is equal to NS by NP, where NS stands for the number of turns in the secondary coil, and NP stands for the number of turns in the primary coil, which is equal to IP by IS. Q factor. Q factor is equal to 1 by R root of L by C. Growth and decay of current in the RL circuit. During growth of the current in the RL circuit, I is equal to I0 into 1 minus e to the power of minus R by L into T. During decay of the current, you can see growth, it is now going to be this much. And when it is now going to be during the decay, it is I is equal to I0 into e to the power of minus R by L T. Time constant of RL circuit tau is equal to L by R. Now coming to changing and discharging of a capacitor through resistor. During charging of a capacitor through resistance, it is something analogous to the previous equation, which is our growth, right? Growth of current. Same way, during charging, it is now going to be Q is equal to Q0 into 1 minus e to the power of minus E by RC. And during discharging, it is now going to be Q is equal to Q0 into e to the power of minus E by RC. Time constant of RC circuit is given by tau is equal to RC. Next is mean value and virtual value of AC. EM T tends to T by 2, then it gives you 2, that is the period starts from 0, that is what is meant by 0 to T by 2. So when T is equal to 0, from there it moves to T by 2, then it is given by 2 E0 by pi, which is equal to 0.637 E0. EM from T by 2 to T is given by 2 E0 by pi, which is equal to minus 0.637 E0. Again, EM from 0 to T is given as 0, because it is now going to be, you can now see when you add both, it's going to get cancelled off, so it is now going to be 0. Same way, IM through half cycle, the current through half the cycle is given by plus or minus 2i by pi, which is equal to plus or minus 0.637 I0. IM for full cycle, again, it gets cancelled, it is now going to be 0. Same way, EB is equal to E0 by root 2, which is equal to 0.707 E0. And IV is equal to I0 by root 2, which is equal to 0.707 I. Alternating circuit contains resistance only, where it contains only resistance. Then you can say effective resistance to AC is R. So IV is equal to EV by R. There is no phase change introduced here. So E is equal to E0 sin omega t, and I is equal to I0 sin omega t. AC circuit containing only inductor, you know, alternating current through an inductor lags behind the alternating EMF by the phase of 90 degrees. So E is equal to E0 sin omega t, but I is equal to I0 sin of omega t minus 90 degrees. It has got a phase angle of where it lags behind. So that is why we have minus 90 degrees. Inductive reactance, XL is equal to omega L is equal to 2 pi mu L, or IV is equal to EV by XL. So average power consumed per cycle is equal to EV IV cos 90, which is equal to 0. And AC circuit containing resistance and inductance only. Then alternating current in RL circuit lags behind the applied alternating EMF by a phase angle of phi, where tan phi is equal to XL by R, which is equal to omega L by R. Impedance Z is equal to root of R squared plus XL squared, which is equal to root of R squared plus omega L the whole squared. Or IV is equal to EV by Z, which is equal to EV by root of R squared plus XL squared. Because it does not have a capacitance, it is just got resistance and inductance alone. So we don't consider XC here. It's now going to be EV by root of R squared plus XL squared. So these are the important formulae and concepts you have to learn, children. Now quickly, let us go to the test. So these are the different subject tests we have for physics, chemistry, and biology for class 1, class 11, and class 12. You have the NEET full tests also. So whichever subject you want to choose, you can choose. Now we are choosing physics. You have the chapter wise tests here. The red blue bubble says you have not taken the test. The green bubble says you have attempted the test already. But even if you have attempted once, you can take it any number of times. The red bubble says it's a random test, and yellow says it is an incomplete test. So go through the NEET lessons properly, NEET revision tests properly. Make yourself thorough with the formulae, and then you can attempt the test. So if you're not thorough, or if you're not happy with the results, you can as well pick the test, go to the revision notes again, make yourself thorough with everything, and then take the test again. Okay. So now coming to the alternating current. Yeah, I'm taking the first test. Understand? Go to the test. Yeah, the first question. The square loop of side 10 centimeters and resistance 0.5 ohms is placed vertically in the east-west plane. A uniform magnetic field of 0.10 tesla is set up across the plane in the northeast direction. The magnetic field is decreased to zero in 0.70 seconds at a steady rate. Determine the magnitudes of induced EMF E and current I during this time interval. All right, let's quickly solve this. So the angle theta made by the vector area of the coil with the magnitude is given as 45 degrees. And the initial magnetic flux, you know, is phi is equal to VA cos theta. So phi is equal to 0.1 into A is 10 to the power of minus 2 by root 2 Webers. Now the final flux is now given by phi minimum, which is equal to 0. So change in flux is brought about in 0.70 seconds. Okay. So the magnitude of the induced EMF is given by E is equal to modulus of delta phi B divided by delta T. Or this is equal to modulus of delta phi minus 0 divided by delta T. Now substitute the values. It gives you E is equal to 10 to the power of minus 3 divided by root 2 into 0.7. So that gives you 1.0 MV. And the magnitude of the current, you know, is given by I is equal to E by R. Now I is equal to, now you know E is R 1 by R is 0.5. So that gives you 2 milliampere. So it is 1 and 2 milliampere. Let us see which option is correct. 1 and 2 milliampere, option A is correct. Save that. Go to the next. A circular coil of radius 10 centimeters, 500 turns, and resistance 2 ohms is placed with its plane perpendicular to the horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field. It is rotated about its vertical diameter through 180 degrees in 0.25 seconds. Estimate the magnitudes of the EMF and current induced in the coil. Horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field at the place is given as 3 into 10 to the power of minus 5 Tesla. Alright, let us solve this. So, go through the data. Same way, you can say phi 1 is equal to, or phi I is equal to BA cos theta, which is equal to 3 into 10 to the power of minus 5 into I into 10 to the power of minus 2 into cos 0. You know, cos 0 is 1. So that gives you 3 pi into 10 to the power of minus 7 Webers. This is initial. Phi I is initial. Now, final flux is now going to be 3 into 10 to the power of minus 5 into I into 10 to the power of minus 2 into cos 0. So, magnitude, you know, E is equal to N into delta phi by delta t. So, that is now going to give you the estimated value of induced EMF, which is nothing but delta E is equal to N delta phi by delta t. Now, we know it is given that N is equal to 500 and this is now going to be so that is equal to 500 into, so initial flux plus final flux totally, that is now going to give you 6 pi into 10 to the power of minus, oh sorry children, this is 10 to the power of minus 7. So 6 pi into 10 to the power of minus 7 divided by delta t is given as 0.25, which is equal to 3.8 into 10 to the power of minus 3 volts. And magnitude of current is known, I is equal to E by R, or 3.8 divided by R, given R is given. R is given as 2 ohms. So 3.8 into 10 to the power of minus 3 divided by 2, that gives you 1.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 amperes. So, let's see which option is correct. 3.8 and 1.9. Yes, option B is correct. Save that. Go to the next. A wheel with 10 metallic spokes, each of 0.5 meters long, is rotated with a speed of 120 revolutions per minute in a plane normal to the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field, HE, at a place. If HE is equal to 0.4G at that place, what is the induced EMF between the axle and the rim of the wheel? Note that 1G is equal to 10 to the power of minus 4 Tesla. All right. Let's quickly solve this. Induced EMF E is given by half W dr square, or which is equal to half into 4 pi into 0.4 into 10 to the power of minus 4, because E given and radius is 0.5 square. Okay. So, when you calculate and simplify this and calculate, that gives you 6.28 into 10 to the power of minus 5 joules. Let's see what's the option. 6.28. So 6.28, option A is correct. A wheel with 10 metallic spokes, each of 0.3 long, is rotated with a speed of 120 revolutions per minute in a plane normal to the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field, HE, at a place, which is, this problem is very much similar to the previous one which we did. So HE, given that that place is 0.4 G, what is the induced EMF between the axle and the rim of the wheel? Note that 1 G is equal to 10 to the power of minus 4 Tesla. That was 5 meters long, and here it is. So the radius was 5 there, and here it is 0.3. Let us quickly solve it using the same formula. You know, E is equal to. E is equal to half B omega R square, which is equal to half 4 pi into B is 0.4 into 10 to the power of minus 4 into R squared is 0.3 squared. When you simplify this, that gives you 2.26 into 10 to the power of minus 5 volts. Let's see which option is correct. Yeah, option D is correct. So save that. Ramp pedals are stationary bicycle whose pedals are attached to 1000 turn coil of area 0.10 meter square. The coil rotates at half a revolution per second, and it is placed in a uniform magnetic field of 0.01 Tesla perpendicular to the axis of rotation of the coil. What is the maximum voltage generated in the coil? This is quite easy. So given N is given, A is given, B is given. So it is now going to be easy for you to calculate now. You know, F is given as 0.5 hertz. See, here in this problem, you have the frequency given, that is mu. So N is equal to 1000. A is equal to 0.1 meter square. B is given as 0.01 Tesla. So all the data is given. Quickly substitute in the formula. Epsilon 0 is equal to NBA omega, you know, but instead of omega, since frequency is given, you can write it as N. I knew. Having known all the values, it's not going to be direct substitution. 0.01 into 0.1 into 2 into 3.14 into 0.5, which is equal to 3.14 volts. Let's see which option is correct. 3.14. So you have two. 0.314. So our answer was, so you'll have to be careful with the decimals, children. So 3.14 volts. Ram is pedaling his bicycle down a road perpendicular to Earth's magnetic field of 5.5 10 to the power of minus 5 Tesla. His wheel has an area of 1.2 meters square. What is the flux through the metal rim of his bicycle wheel? So here A is given as 1.2 meters square. B is 5.5 into 10 to the power of minus 5 Tesla. Phi is equal to, you know, BA, which is equal to 1.2 into 5.5 into 10 to the power of minus 5. So that gives you 6.6 into 10 to the power of minus 5 Webers. Let's see which option is correct. 6.6. Yeah, option A is correct. Click that, go to the next. A circular area of circular coil of area 0.04 meter square, 200 turns, resistance 2 ohms, changes from 0.1 Weber per meter square to 0.04 Weber per meter square in 0.02 seconds. Find the induced EMF. So A is given, number of turns is given, R is given, and The change in flux is also given. So let's see. And the time taken is also given. Now let's quickly calculate that. So N is equal to 200. A is equal to 0.04 meter square. B1 is equal to 0.1 Weber per meter square. B2 is 0.04 Weber per meter square. So everything is given. So induced EMF E is equal to minus d5 by dt. So which is nothing but minus d by dt of n dt. Here n and a are constant. The varying thing is now going to be the flux here. So which is nothing but I'll take the constant outside. So minus of n a outside. So that will give you what is the change in flux? B2 minus B1 by dt. Now having known all the values, substitute minus 200 into 0.04 into B2 minus B1 is 0.04 minus 0.1 divided by 0.02. So when you calculate that, that gives you 24 volts. Right? 24 volts. Negative and negative signs will get cancelled, so you get 24 volts. Yeah, option A is correct. Save that, go to the next. An aircraft having a wind span of 20.48 meters flies due north at a speed of 40 meters per second. If the vertical component of Earth's magnetic field at the place is 2 into 10 to the power of minus 5 Tesla, calculate the EMF induced between the ends of these wings. This is a very important sum, children. I have seen repeating this in many papers. So this is a very easy problem. Having known all the values, it is now going to be direct application. That's it. So B is given, L is given, V is given, velocity is given. So you are now going to substitute to calculate the. So E is equal to minus of VLE. Having known all values, minus of 2 into 10 to the power of minus 5 into L is 20.8 into 40. V is 40. So when you simplify this, that gives you minus of 0.0164 volts. Yeah, now look children, A and B have same values, only the sign changes. Now, remember, if you go wrong in the symbols, then your option, you'll have to choose the correct option. We have got the negative sign, so option A will be correct. Even though B has got, A and B have the same options, you'll have to choose the correct symbol there. So since we've got a negative symbol, you'll have to choose A. So save that, go to the next. So while doing the exams, don't be in a hurry. That is why we are asking you to take these exams again and again so that you'll be thorough of what to click, which option to click and choose. And then because when while doing the exams, you will often tend to go wrong by just clicking the wrong options. Okay, so even though you would have calculated everything correctly, you would have done everything correctly, but the symbols will the symbols will cheat you. Okay, so you'll be get cheated by the symbols. So remember which symbol you have calculated, if it is going to be plus or minus. So if it is going to be plus, choose the other option. If it is going to be minus, choose it. So never go wrong in these. You'll be carried away by these small mistakes. Okay, so never fall a prey into these. All these are small traps where you can easily fall. Okay, so be careful. That is why we are asking you to take these tests again and again so that you'll be thorough with the concepts. Okay, now coming to the ninth one. The circular coil of N is equal to 5 turns with radius R is equal to 1.73 meters is subjected to a varying magnetic field that changes uniformly from 2.18 Tesla to 12.7 Tesla in an interval of 180 seconds. The axis of the solenoid makes an angle of 27 degrees to the magnetic field. Find the induced EMF. All right. So N is given, R is given. Change in flux is given and P is given, angle is given, so it is now going to be P. All the values are given, so it is going to be very easy for you to calculate once you know the formula. So, you know, let us take the, So, we all know that N is going to be 5. N is given as 5. R is equal to 1.73 meters. V1 is equal to 2.18 Tesla and V2 is 12.7 Tesla. Theta is equal to 27 degrees. All right. Now you know E is equal to minus of d5 by dt. So again, as we'll substitute the formula directly here. So d by dt of nba cos theta, which is equal to, so nA into d2 minus b1 divided by dt is now going to be the change in time taken. So that is already given, the time taken is given. Now calculate quickly, substitute all the values. N is 5, A is pi r squared, pi into r is given as 1.73, so 1.73 squared into b2 is 12.7 minus 2.18 divided by 180, so that gives you 2.45 volts. Let's see which option is correct. 2.45 volts, yes, that is correct. Save that, go to the next. Calculate the mutual inductance between two coils when a current of 4 amperes changing to 8 amperes in 0.5 seconds in one coil induces an EMF of 50 millivolts in the other coil. So change in current is given, time is given, induced EMF is given. So he is asking you to calculate the mutual inductance, which is quite easy. We have given that in the neat notes. You can quickly recollect what was the formula here. So we know that E is equal to M into DI by DT. So given E is equal to 50 millivolts, which is equal to 50 into 10 to the power of minus 3 volts. The conversion is very important, children. So I1 is given as 4 amperes and I2 is given as 8 amperes and dt is 0.5 seconds. So M is equal to, it is now going to be E into dt by di. Alright, so which is nothing but having known all the values, you can quickly substitute that into 0.5 divided by 8 minus 4, which is nothing but minus 6.25 into 10 to the power of minus 8. Just a second, children. Changes. When a current of 4 amperes changing to 8. All right. So, again, here we will have to be careful with the symbol. It is minus here. So, I forgot to make the negative symbol here. So, that is not going to be a minus here. So, we have a minus symbol here. So, again, look into the options. You have two options here. 6.25 into the power of minus 3 and minus 6.25 into the power of minus 3. So, choose that. Go to the next. A bulb connected to 50 volts DC consumes 20 watts power Then the bulb is connected to a capacitor in an AC power supply of 250 volts, 50 hertz. Find the value of the capacitor required so that the bulb draws the same amount of current. All right. So now we can see power. Okay, let's see. The data is given. So he's asking you to find the value of the capacitor. All right. So, you know, power P is equal to V into I. So therefore, from this we get I is equal to P by V, which is equal to 20 by 50, which is given. So 0.4 amperes. And R is equal to V by I. Voltage is given as 50. You have calculated I to be 0.4, which is equal to 125 ohms. So now we know I, we know R. So Z is equal to the V power supply, which is given by V power supply by I, which is equal to 250 is the power supply, 250 volts. So that divided by I, we have calculated as 0.4, which is equal to 625 ohms. So impedance Z is going to be, so we are here, we have the, this is now going to be a capacitive circuit. So resistance and capacitance are there. So the impedance is now going to be root of R square plus XC the whole square, which is nothing but root of R square plus 1 minus C omega the whole square. I told you XC is the capacitive reactant. So C omega, XC is nothing but 1 by C omega. So since the frequency is given, we cannot use omega. We know omega is equal to 2 pi mu. So in the place of omega, let us substitute that. So that would give you root of R square plus 1 by 2 pi mu C the whole square. All right. So from this we get C is equal to, we need to calculate C, simplify that. And you can simply see that it is now going to be C is equal to 1 by 2 pi root of Z square minus R square. Now we know Z, we know R, you can easily calculate this. This is now going to be 1 by 2 pi root of impedance, we calculated to be 625, right? So 625 minus 125, which is equal to 5.198 microfarad. Okay, 5.198 microfarad. Option D is correct. Select that, go to the next. Power loss in AC circuit will be minimum when high resistance, low reduction, high resistance, high inductance, low resistance, low inductance, low resistance, high inductance. Now, you know, power is directly proportional to R by L. Okay. P is proportional to R by L. That means P will be minimum when L will be maximum. But P and R are directly proportional. So L maximum and R minimum. So you can see, option D is correct. The current flowing in two coaxial coils in the same direction, if we increase the distance between the two, the electric current will increase, decrease, remain the same, cannot be determined. So which can be? So now you know, as the distance between the two coils is increased, the induced current in both the coils assists the main current. Okay, the induced current which is now going to develop in the two coils, they are now going to assist the main current. So therefore, current through each coil increases. So option A can be correct. Okay. A magnet is dropped inside a long hollow vertical metal pipe. During the fall, the acceleration of the magnet will decrease continuously, will decrease up to a value which is less than G, may increase or decrease, will decrease to zero and will attain terminal speed. All right. Now, you know, the falling magnet will experience force and upward force. Okay, this is now going to experience an upward force. And so the acceleration of the magnet will decrease. Okay, acceleration. So since it is now going to have an upward force, it is now going to decrease. The acceleration is now going to decrease. And then the magnet will acquire a terminal speed. After that, it will now acquire a terminal speed. So So it may increase or decrease. Okay. So, yeah. So even though he says it decreases to zero and will attain the thermal speed, so that cannot be the option. So it may increase or decrease. So, okay. Last one. When a wire loop is rotated in a magnetic field, the direction of induced EMF changes every quarter rotation, does not change, changes for every half rotation, changes for every rotation. Let's quickly solve that. Now, you know, the flux of the magnetic field through the loop is given by phi is equal to d pi r squared, where a b a, in the place of a, I'm writing it as d pi r squared cos of omega t, where phi is the angle the normal makes with the portion of the loop induced, the what was now going to be induced. So E is equal to, now the induced EMF E is now going to be given by omega B pi R squared. So that means it is nothing but dphi by dt. It's not. We are now going to differentiate this equation with respect to t. Okay. So that would give you d phi by dt, which is nothing. So I'll put it like this: d phi by dt, which is equal to e. Okay. So which is now on differentiating this, you know, I'll get it as cos omega t will be omega sine omega minus omega sine omega t. So that will give you minus omega b phi r squared sine omega t. So this will be zero when omega t is equal to. So when it will be zero. When omega t is equal to n pi, because sine 0 is 0, sine n pi is 0. So that means when omega t, I'll put it omega t is equal to theta. Okay? So in that case, theta where omega t can take values 0, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi and so on. So you can see that the induced EMF will change for every half a rotation. Okay? So option C should be correct. So we have completed the test. Save that. Can end the test. Let's see the results. Yeah, all our answers were right. So if all your answers are right, then that is shown by your green color. Had it been incorrect, then it would have been shown by the red color. If you'd have forgotten to save the answer, then it would have indicated as an unanswered question, which is colored by red, yellow. So if you want, if suppose you have gone wrong in some answer, some question is when your answer was wrong, what you can do is you can as well go to that. So had it been red color, you can just click that. Say for example, let me take question number 11. A bulb cut. So, as was correct, support had it been a wrong answer, then you can quickly look into the correct answer and then take on the explanation part also. See, the explanation is also given here. So, you can verify your answer. So, like this, you can go do the test any number of times. Okay. So, you can, until or otherwise, you are going to be thorough with each and every test. So, there are about 117 tests which are chapter-wise tests you can do. Umpteen times, you can do any number of times. Every time go to the revision notes, make yourself thorough of all the concepts and then take the test. Even if you are, it's okay. If you're not going to, I mean, if you're not thorough, go again. You can stop anytime. Take the test. You can stop the test, go back to the revision notes, make yourself thorough again. So likewise, but you know, practice makes the man perfect, right? So only practice. So by practicing so many times, I'm sure you students will crack this NEET exams with a very good results. Okay. So do you have any doubts, children?